1 Samuel 29. Sorry, 28. I did this message for Homeschool Chapel, but I thought it would be good to do it here today. If you're there, this is the name of my message: How You Know How Far You've Turned From God, and verse 8 through 20. And Saul disguised himself and put on other raiments and went, and two men with him, and they came to the woman by night, and he said, I pray thee, divine unto me by the familiar spirit, and bring me him who I shall name unto you, unto thee, sorry. And the woman said unto him, Behold, thou knowest that Saul hath come down, he hath cut off those that have familiar spirits and the wizards of the land, wherefore thou layest a snare for my life, and to cause me to die. And Saul sware to her by the Lord, saying, As the Lord liveth, there shall be no punishment happen to thee for this thing. Then said the woman, Who shall I bring unto thee? And he said, Bring me up Samuel. And then the woman saw Samuel, and she cried with a loud voice. The woman spake to Saul, saying, Thou hast deceived me, for thou art Saul. The king said to her, Be not afraid for what thou sawest. And the woman said unto Saul, I saw God's ascending unto the earth. And he said unto her, What form is he of? And she said, An old man cometh up, and he is covered with a mantle. And Saul perceived that it was Samuel. And he stood up on his face on the ground and bowed himself. And Samuel did to Saul, Why hast thou disquieted me to bring me up? And Saul answered, I am sore distressed, and the Philistines make war against me. And God has departed from me, and answereth me no more, neither by prophet nor dreams. Therefore I have called to thee, that thou makest known unto me. What shall I do? Then said Samuel, Wherefore dost thou ask of me, seeing the Lord has departed from thee, and is become thine enemy? And the Lord hath done to him as he spake for me. For the Lord hath rent the kingdom out of thine hand, and given it to thy neighbor, even to David, because thou obeyest not the voice of the Lord, nor exaltest his fierce wrath upon Ahimelech. Therefore hath the Lord done this thing unto thee this day. Moreover, the Lord will also deliver Israel with thee into the hand of the Philistines. And tomorrow shalt thou and thy sons be with me. The Lord also shall deliver the host of Israel into the hands of the Philistine. Then Saul fell straightway along the earth, and was sore afraid because of the word Samuel, and there was no strength in him, for he had eaten no bread all the day nor night. All right, let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for letting me be able to come up here to preach today, and please give me the words to say, and please help Mrs. Drake. In Jesus' name, amen. I have 3 points. My first one is who you turn to, verses 7 and 9. Then 7 through 9, sorry. Then said Saul unto his servants, Seek me a woman that hath a familiar spirit, that I may go to her and inquire of her. And his servant said to him, Behold, there is a woman that hath a familiar spirit at Endor. And Saul disguised himself and put on other raiments and went, and two men with him. They came to the woman by night, and he said, I pray thee, divine unto me by a familiar spirit, and bring him up who I shall name unto thee. And the woman said, He said to him, Beholdest thou knowest what Saul hath done, and hath cut off those who with the familiar spirit and the wizard of the land. Therefore thou layest a snare for my life to cause me to die. First of all, we see who Saul turns to. He turns to the world instead of God. We need to turn to God instead of the world. Saul's already lost everything, because a while back in chapter can't remember what chapter it was, but a while back, Saul offered an offering to the Lord because Samuel wasn't there yet, and he wasn't patient on the, he didn't wait for the Lord. He just went ahead and did it his own way, and then he got cursed, and God took away his protection and everything. And my second point is, are you a Christian who hides yourself? Verse 8, and then we'll go to verse 12. And Saul disguised himself and put on other raiments, and he went, and two men with him, and they came to the woman by night, and he said, I pray thee, divine unto me the familiar spirit, and bring him up whom I shall name unto thee. Now verse 12. And when the woman saw Samuel, and she cried with a loud voice, and then the woman spake to Saul, saying, why hast thou deceived me? For thou art Saul. What I mean here by, are you a Christian who hides yourself? In verse 8, Saul disguised himself, like putting on a raiment, like maybe a dirty one, because a king wouldn't wear something dirty. He would wear something clean and pure. And so you wouldn't just, if you were in a store and you were going to steal, you wouldn't tuck it in your coat. I mean, just wave it at the security camera, give them all your personal information, then stick it in your coat. You would look around, make sure nobody's watching, maybe go behind a shelf or under the clothes, and then stick it in your pocket. And then my third point and my final point, how you know when you have turned completely from God, because he will remove his protection. Verse 18 through 19. Moreover, the Lord will also deliver Israel into thine hand of the Philistine, and tomorrow shalt thou and thy sons be with me. And the Lord also shall deliver the hosts of Israel into the hand of the Philistine. So it says here that when Saul disobeyed the final time, God just took his hand off of Samuel. I mean, sorry, off of Saul, because Saul had turned so many times. Jesus said God has already given him so many chances, but the final one, God just removed his hand, and Saul just kind of went with the world now. And then later on, Saul dies, and that's all I have.
Proverbs chapter 1, Psalms chapter 1, Psalms chapter 1. Before I get started, I'd like to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for allowing us to come here and hear your word. Thank you for allowing us to be able to stand up here and present your word, Lord. I pray that you would help me and the rest of us that are preaching calm our nerves, Lord, and help us present your word correctly, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Okay, in Psalms 1, we're going to start in verse 1. It says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor the sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Now I'd like everyone to get an image in their mind real quick. So imagine right there, there's two trees, one on each side, except this one over here has a river flowing by it. We're going to have those indicate the man who just doesn't care about his Bible, and then the one who actually reads in his Bible. In verse 2, it's a... Let's actually start in verse 1. It says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. So this man over here, he is in his Bible constantly reading, trying to grow in the word of the Lord, meditating on it, not just reading it, setting it aside, going about his day, going about his business. He's in the word trying to get some out of it to bring throughout life, and to where he can even present to other people to help him. Now, let's go to verse 3. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor the sinners in the congregation of the righteous. So that's going to be this other tree who doesn't care, doesn't do anything about it. So I'd also like you to picture in your mind a drought. So this tree, it's going to wither. It's going to die. Leaves, going to be like chaff. Wind blows it away. This tree, it has a river by it. You all know rivers, when the drought comes, they don't just completely dry up because they're a big body of water. They have plenty of water. So this tree, it's going to stay alive. It's going to prosper and still have fruit. So that's what's going to happen if you're in God's word. You're going to stay by him. He's going to allow you to prosper even when the trials come. So now, this is six verses right here. In these six verses, it gives you what to do, what you need to do in order to keep in God's word, to keep being fruitful and prosper in his word. It says meditate in his word. This is just six verses giving you all this wisdom. God gave us an entire Bible in order to read, read, and meditate on, that we can grow in his word. So in verse 6 it says, "For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish." In the end, we're going to be taken to heaven. We're not going to worry about anything else in this world, whether it's Trump or Hillary. We're not going to worry about another election like that again. Thank goodness for that, right? But the sinners, they do not have heaven to look forward to. They don't have anything to look forward to besides hell, eternal like a fire. That's not something we want for them. So we need to meditate in God's word, learn God's word. That way we can successfully present it to them and lead them to Christ. That's all I have.
Been there, done that, brother. All right, if you all would turn in your Bibles to 2 Timothy 2, please. They say a lot of good sermons, they start out with a joke. I don't have one. Anyways, if you would, when you get to 2 Timothy 2, somebody say amen. Well, I get there. I'm going to be reading verses 3 through 4 right here. "Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of his life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier." We see here in verses 3 and 4, the Bible is talking about the good soldier of Jesus Christ. The title of my message is The Good Soldier. So let's start out. I'm going to go ahead and pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Lord, thank you for the two messages we've already heard. Lord, please be with me while I'm up here. Please calm me down a little bit. And help everybody get something from this. Not what I say, but your word. And give us all a safe ride home after this. In your name I pray. Amen. All right. It's a good soldier. Well, everybody wants to be a good soldier for Christ. Well, if I were to ask everybody to raise your hand, say, would you want to be a good soldier? Probably most everybody would say, yeah, I want to be a good one. Well, in order to be a good soldier, the first thing you have to do is you have to enlist. Doesn't have it in this verse, but it's pretty common knowledge. First thing you have to do is, when you enlist, there's requirements. Like, if you ever read the prayer pamphlets I hand out, you've probably seen that I was trying to be a police officer, and they have requirements for that. One of the requirements would be is I have to fill out a written exam, and I have to prove that I'm not, you know, mentally retarded and just not, you know, I'm able to do simple things. And the second thing I have to do is I have to go to a physical exam, and I have to do running, etc. And the next thing would be I have to sit under a lie detector test. And there's just a lot of little things that you have to do that this is just to become a police officer. Where God has a much stricter code in order for you to be in his army. He actually requires perfection. And as you know, none of us were perfect. None of us are. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned." So we're all sinners, meaning we don't meet God's pretty much only requirement, which is perfection, to be in his army. So because we're all sinners, the Bible says in 1 John 1:9, let me turn that right click. This is a different part. Because we're all sinners, we can't be in it. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So in order for us to enlist, we have to realize that we're a sinner, first off. And then we have to ask forgiveness of our sins. And we see right here that God will forgive us of our sins. Then Romans 10:9. Let me turn there right quick. Y'all don't have to turn with me. Bible says, thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So this is the enlistment process. You have to realize that you're a sinner. You have to realize that you have a need for a Savior, and he's the only way. You have to admit your sins to him and ask him into your heart and realize that he died for you, came to this earth, was buried, and 3 days later he rose again. And that is how you enlist. So talking to enlisted soldiers now, we've gotten through that. The Bible says that if you've been enlisted, we can look at this soldier that I just read about. This soldier is, he can be seen as patient. In verse number 3, let me get back to my original text, 2 Timothy 2, verse 3, if you are there. It says, thou therefore endure hardness. It starts out with endure. He has patience. He endures things and he doesn't quit. The good soldier realizes that there will be troubles along the way and he will not be deterred by them. He understands that pain is often part of the Christian experience. 1 Peter 4:1 is what I have written down here. Let me turn there. You don't have to go with me. Should have these written down. Live and learn. For as much then as in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind, for he hath suffered in the flesh and hath ceased from sin. This is talking about suffering. There will be pain in the Christian experience. You won't get through this without pain. But the Bible doesn't say there won't be pain. It just says the Lord will be with you through it. And then the next part is his priorities. We're looking to look at his priorities in verse 4. It says, and no man warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. The priorities is to please the commander. We're not here on this earth to please ourselves. We're not here on this earth to do what we want. We're here on this earth for a purpose, and that purpose is to please the commander, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. And he has no higher goal in this life. He's pressing towards the mark for the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus. The good soldier knows that anything that interferes with his performance in the military must be done away with. The soldier, he practices guarding the truth. If you turn over from 2 Timothy to chapter 4 of 2 Timothy, and we'll read in verse 7. It says, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. Kept the faith is what we're looking at here. The soldier, in this word, it uses kept, which means to guard or watch over. It's because it's important to him. Let me give you an example. My first car was a Monte Carlo. If you ever talked to me, you've probably heard me talk about it before. I love my car. So I kept my car. I guarded it. I would change the oil way before it needed to be done. I would change everything on it. I mean, my tires, my brakes, my anything that I could find on the car, I would end up replacing it. Why? Because I love my car, and I kept it, and I did everything I could to guard it, watch over it. That way, it stayed with good working condition all the time. Well, a soldier here, he kept the faith. He was always maintaining it, always trying to get more from it, and always trying to make sure that when the time came, it would be where it needed to be, and it'd be working. He didn't just let it sit in the garage like I would my car. He didn't put his Bible down and leave it there for, you know, just to the next Sunday service. He kept his faith. He was always guarding it and keeping it with him. And he was determined to do a good job, this soldier. He refused to do anything that would bring disgrace or dishonor to his superior, to the Lord. And we go on to the next point. He's familiar. The soldier, he knows the sound of his commander's voice. The Bible says, we're sheep and we know the sound of our shepherd, and the way to get more familiar with the Lord's voice is to spend more time listening to it. You do this by getting into his word. You read his word. That way when he speaks, you'll know it's him. And the soldier also, he knew his skills, his weapons. I have Ephesians 6:10 through 18 for time's sake. Not like I'm going to run out, actually, but I'm not going to read that. The good soldier knows that when he's engaged in mortal warfare, the only way to succeed is to fight using his spiritual weapons proficiently. You and I would do well to learn the art of spiritual warfare if we intend to succeed for the glory of the Lord by using our weapons, by using our Bible verses, by talking to the Lord, asking him for help, and by going to people like Pastor when you need something. And then he knows the strategy of the enemy. 2 Corinthians 11:14. Turn there right quick, if you would, please. Doth not even nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it is shame in him? That's the wrong verse. Well, 2, that makes more sense. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. So know the strategy of the enemy. The good soldier knows that the enemy is always active, he never rests. The good soldier knows that the enemy is shrewd and always attacking. He knows, but he also knows that the Lord is there to help him. This is back to the previous point of knowing how to use your weapons. The Lord is the most powerful one, and he's always available for you. He knows that regardless of the trap, God always has a way for him, and there's a way of escape, and God's always there with him. This moves me to my next point. Soldier, he's a fighter. If you go back to 2 Timothy 4, please. Back down to verse 7. It says, I have fought the good fight. It doesn't say that I have showed up at church Sunday and went home and didn't do anything after that. You know, I worked my job. That's good enough, right? One time I talked about one of my coworkers. I said, I'm a Christian, you know. No, he's a fighter. It doesn't say that he went home and just lived his life going Sunday to Sunday. He got up every day and he lived his life for Christ. He was fighting for him. He was determined. A good soldier doesn't retreat in the face of the enemy. He doesn't run and fight. He doesn't run from a fight. Instead, he stands around and fights the battle until the battle is over. We are to finish our fight running the race for the Lord and not retreating, running from the sins of this earth that, you know, honestly can be pretty frightening. I'm 22. I'm invincible, right? That's what I tell myself. But even me, I'm really afraid of a lot of things that go on. But instead of me getting up and hiding that I'm a Christian, I should be going to work. I should be going everywhere I go and freely admitting that, yes, I'm a Christian. Yes, that I know the Lord is my Savior. And when I come across opposition, which I do, I shouldn't be running in the face of it. I should be able to stand my ground and have my tools ready with my Bible verses and stuff that I've read and memorized and able to give to people and know how to tell them about the Savior who died on the cross for them. And a good soldier realizes that the battle does not run according to his time frame. He knows that another's in charge of the duration of the battle, but a good soldier is driven to finish. The good soldier in this battle, the good soldier is in the battle. Are you? He's dedicated. The good soldier dedicates himself to keeping his oath. He's determined to live for the Lord regardless of the cost. And the last part of my sermon is the good soldier is a finisher. It says in verse 7, kept the faith. And he goes down, because he kept the faith, henceforth there's a crown for me of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not only to me, but to all of them also that love his appearing. So we're reading about one good soldier here. But as we just saw in this verse, there's a crown laid up for everyone that runs the way this good soldier ran. If you join the army of Lord Jesus Christ by accepting him into your heart, you are required by his word to be a good soldier. Are you? And if you are, there's a crown of righteousness waiting for you in heaven. And that's all I have.
So it makes me happy to see my son up here. All right. So please turn to 2 Peter chapter 3. I'll try to keep it short. I know Pastor's wanting to squeeze a few more in here, and he hates the sound of my voice. Oh, it was the socks. I'm going to pray quick. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity to be up here, Lord, and to be yoked to you, Father, is something humbling, and to present your word, Lord, as I do not want to mess up anything from your word, Father. Please help me to present it accurately and to bring something tonight that will speak to someone's heart. If they don't know you, it will lead them to salvation. If they do, then it will encourage them to live righteously. Thank you, Father. Amen. All right, so we're going to turn to 2 Peter chapter 3. It's been a real blessing to be in the Bible college. So unfortunately, Pastor has armed me with a little bit more gumption to get up and speak. So I'm sorry if this goes a little bit long. But we're going to read from 2 Peter chapter 3. And I've heard sermons from this before, and I don't think it really hit the mark with what it was, but it was really good. He gives an example where David said, "Is there not a cause?" And pastors really hammer on that. And it's not exactly what he was talking about. And I've heard sermons from 2 Peter 3 as a warning to the lost man. But we're going to look at this, and I want you to take note of verse 1. Because Peter's writing this book not to the Jews converting to Christianity, not to the lost man. He's writing this to the Christians, the Gentiles, the ones who they don't have that historical background of Judaism in their culture. He's writing this letter to them and telling them something. So this is to the saved person. This is not to the lost person, where he opens up in verse 3. He says, "This second epistle, beloved," which this is the second, being 1 Peter would have been his first one to the church. "So this second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, in both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance." And there's where that semicolon is. This is being written to you as a Christian because you need to remember something. Yes, there is a warning that underlies in here for the lost person. So if you're here tonight, listen closely if you don't know the Lord, because there is a warning for you. But this is meant for the Christian to understand that there is something coming which is going to hold you back if you don't pay attention and remember. There is something to look forward to, and there is something that is going to happen regardless of whether you choose to remember or whether you choose not to. So we're going to continue through verse 10. "That ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lusts." So we're going to stop right there. And so I like to read secular articles about psychology because I find it entertaining, because I find it's just the study of sin, and I find it funny that they study sin from the perspective of sin. It's like watching something consume itself. It's ridiculous. And so there's these two articles, and one said, you know, there's these people who have a hard time remembering good events in their life. All they can remember is the negative. And it's this real short time period we would call present. So in the present, they found out, you remember negative things a lot more because there's this emotion tied to it. So you're going to remember negative because right away you're going to get offended. And there's going to be this emotion tied to it, and you're going to remember. So it's going to leave this heavy mark for a short amount of time. But in a separate study, they found out after a certain amount of time, that starts to dwindle. You're not going to remember that negative anymore. And we saw stuff like that a couple weeks ago when we were looking at the slides. And we saw all the pictures. I've only been here a year, but I was glad I got to recognize some of those events and the faces in there. And I've built relationships with you. And as we look at things like that, or at Casey's funeral, we look at these pictures of them, and you see it. You no longer remember the negative. It's strange, isn't it? You'll look at these pictures, and you'll remember these happy thoughts. I'm sure family camp, there was maybe some discord, some arguing, maybe your children disobeyed. I didn't get to be there. But when you look at the pictures, you don't remember any of that. You're going to have this positive feeling with it because naturally you're going to want to remember the good things. And as Christians, we want to remember the good things. But it's intentional. Unless you look at those pictures, it's not going to happen. The last mark you had was maybe something negative. But until you stir up those pure thoughts, like he says in verse 1, it's not going to happen. It's an intentional act that you have to have in your day. It's something you have to set before you. So conversely, there must be impure thoughts you can stir up. So that's what Paul is warning us about. Because Paul, I mean, we come across, Peter. Did I say Paul a bunch? Okay, I've said Paul a bunch. Peter, so we come across Peter, and he's a man in his mid-60s who spent half of his life serving the Lord. So Peter started as Simon. He was this rugged fisherman who Jesus came across, and he was a manly man. And so now we hear here in Peter, 2 Peter, we see the voice of a different man. He started out as brash and arrogant. He was this fisherman, really tough and rugged, independent. But now we come across Peter, 30 or so years later, And now he's wiser, he's obedient. He's writing a letter with a whole different tone. Now these are the words of God, but he uses the person he wrote, who he wrote through. And so we see Peter here, someone wiser, someone obedient, someone who's giving a warning, because if we look at the history of Peter and his life and the stirring up of a pure mind, how it affected his life, if we look in here, you know, Peter, when he first encountered Jesus, he found his mother-in-law being healed along with many sick and others in Capernaum. Miraculously drew fish on the command of Jesus Christ, raised a little, he saw a little girl be raised from the dead. He walked on water with Jesus Christ. He saw the transfiguration, the appearance of Moses and Elijah. He saw the healing of lepers, the blind and the crippled, the removing of disease from the blood with a touch, as we saw this morning, and the feeding of thousands with a single basket of fish and bread. And after all this, Peter sat at the Lord's Supper, defended Christ from being arrested, even cutting off the ear of the high priest's servant. All of this happened to Peter. And in a short time after witnessing the start of the false trial, Peter forgot. And he denied Christ three times. So Peter's saying, look, I spent 3.5 years with Jesus Christ, and I forgot in a few minutes where I was at and what I was supposed to be doing. This is Peter. At no point is your faith strong enough where you can forget, ever. You have to set up intentional markers in your life, intentional things. That's exactly why Joshua set up 12 stones at the Jordan. And he said, this will be a remembrance to them that we crossed over on dry land. You're going to see exactly what the Lord did and tell your children about it. And that affects here, right here at this church. Because as I went to family camp, I got to see what has happened before I even got here. I'm like those children of Israel. I have no clue what happened before I got here. But I saw the remembrance. I saw the chapel. I saw the grounds. I see this building. And if somebody doesn't tell me, if you don't tell your children how it got here and what the Lord provided, they're going to forget. And it's going to disappear. And then we see something else interesting along with David. So we are studying David with at home. And as you look in verse 8... chapter, going blank here, 18, no, 21. So you look at 1 Samuel 21, you see David, as he comes to Ahimelech, and he's running and fleeing from Saul, and he's forgetting who he is. He's forgetting what he has been promised, because remembering, as Peter has told us, is not just a backwards event. It's a forward event also. That present is just a little mark in your life. You need to remember what God has done for you and what he has promised you. And David forgot. And Ahimelech is talking to him, and he says, give me all the showbread, I'm hungry. Give me 5 loaves. Actually, give me more. Because he forgot he already was taken care of. He also forgot he was going to be taken care of and wanted more, as much as he could get. And Ahimelech said, okay, well, and he gave it to him. And then he said, I need something to defend myself because I had to run in haste from the king, or with the king's commands. And so he said, I need a weapon. And look what happened, what God placed in his life. Ahimelech said, here, I just happen to have the sword of Goliath with me. And David took up that sword, and he said, give it to me. Now, nothing else is said after that about what he thought when he handed that to him. But there are times, intentional or not, God is going to place something in your life, whether you put it there or he has to put it there. And he's going to say, stop and listen. You have to remember what I've done and what I've promised to you. Do you understand what I've given you? Do you understand that I've given you the gospel of Abraham, the promise of Israel? Do you understand that you have been adopted into that? Do you understand the blood that I shed for you on the cross? Do you understand where you came from, how you got here? Because right now doesn't matter. It's what happened with me and what's going to happen with me. Right now does not matter. This circumstance is going to flee very soon. You do not have to worry. And so if you don't remind yourself that those past branches were broken, as in Romans 11, you've been grafted in. Nobody owes you anything. You owe everything to Jesus Christ. You owe everything to those people who came before you, that remnant that remained righteous, that held on to the laws of God, so that you could sit here in this church building one day. That's what you need to remember. And I just wanted to speak to you tonight because there's a lot of remembering that's happened, like last week when we had the Lord's Supper. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we're told in verse 24, take and eat, this is my body which is broken for you. If you don't have "is" circled in your Bible, I suggest you do it. is broken for you. That's an eternal reminder of Jesus Christ. And do this in remembrance of me. What do you have to remember? Have you put things in your life to intentionally remember day to day? Do you have a set something in your life? Every time I look at that ring on my wife's finger, now I'm going to remember the time I answered that prayer. You have to put something in your day to remember, and you have to leave a mark for your children to remember. Because I'm sure Pastor, when he goes to PNG, I'll wrap up here so you can get the next guy. I'm sure when Pastor goes to PNG, he's going to walk down there, he's going to land, and he's going to smell the air, and he's going to remember. He's going to touch those buildings, and he's going to remember. He's going to walk those paths, and he's going to remember. Why? Because of what happened. That's why. But I guarantee you, he's now going to get to go back a second time and see what will be happening without him. Everything was set in place by God. He was just one of the workers there. And Peter goes forward to remind us that the scoffers will come. It's not just something you need to do out of good virtue. The scoffers are going to come, and you're going to have your walls torn down if you do not have something to remember. Because do you want the last thing in your mind to be scripture, or do you want the last thing to be in your mind something you heard in a movie or on TV or something somebody at work said, and you have nothing to replace that with the scripture of God? So I'm asking you to please remember, I'm not going to be here forever. So please, I want to come back in 10 years, 15 years. I want to see this church grow. I want to see amazing things here because you told your children to remember, and you remembered what God had promised. All right, thank you.
Tonight I'd like to start with opening our Bibles to James chapter 1. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you for giving me the opportunity to preach. I thank you for giving me a good church to come to. And I pray that tonight you would help me give something to these people that would help them positively in their lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I would like to start in verse 2. My brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Let patience have a perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. The title of my message tonight is Remembrance for Patience. I'd like to go to Exodus chapter 32. I'm going to start with verse 1, then I'm going to jump down to verse 7. It says, "And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mountain, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, Up, make us gods which shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what has become of him." Now skip down to verse 7, and it says, "And the Lord said unto Moses, Go get thee down, for thy people, which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt, have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made them a molten calf, and have worshipped it, and have sacrificed thereunto, and said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which have brought thee up out of the land of Egypt." Now I'm going to skip to verse 20. And it says, "And he took the calf which they had made, and burnt it in the fire, and the ground, and ground it to powder, and strewed it upon the water, and made the children of Israel to drink of it." So you see, the children of Israel got impatient with Moses because he had been gone up on the mountain. So they went to Aaron, and they asked him to make them gods. And as you can see, their consequence was he ground up the calf, put it in their water, made them drink it. But that was the consequence that Moses made for them. If you read earlier in the chapter, while Moses is still up on the mountain, God offers to destroy the children of Israel and remake them through Moses. So that is just one thing to see from this, that man has his own punishment, and God has his. Next, I'd like to go to Numbers 20. And I'm going to start reading in verse 9. And Moses took the rod from before the Lord, as he commanded him. And Moses and Aaron gathered the congregation together before the rock, and he said unto them, Hear now, ye rebels, must we fetch you water out of this rock? And Moses lifted up his hand, and with his rod he smote the rock twice, and the water came out abundantly, and the congregation drank, and their beast also. And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron, Because ye believe me not to sanctify me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore ye shall not bring this congregation into the land which I have given them. You can also see it with Moses. When he got frustrated and lost patience with the children of Israel, he disobeyed the Lord and smote the rock instead of speaking to it. And because of that, he wasn't allowed to lead the children of Israel into the promised land. Next, I would like to go to Joshua chapter 7. And I'll start reading in verse 1. But the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed things for Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zibdi, the son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed things, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. And Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Bethaven, on the east side of the Bethel, and spake unto them, saying, Go up and view the country. And the men went up and viewed Ai. And they returned to Joshua and said unto him, Let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and smite Ai, and make not all the people to labor thither, for they are but few. So there went up thither of the people about 3,000 men, and they fled before the men of Ai. And the men of Ai smote them about 36 men, for they chased them from before the gates even unto Shibrim, and smote them in the going down. Wherefore the hearts of the people melted and became as water. You can see in Joshua that after his victory of Jericho, he completely forgot God and went on their own strength. When he lost patience in waiting for God, if he would have waited for God, he would have known that Achan had sinned and that he should have dealt with that before going to Ai. And because of that, 6 men died. And lastly, I would like to go to 1 Samuel chapter 13. I'm going to start reading in verse 7. And some of the Hebrews went over Jordan to the land of Gad and Gilead. As for Saul, he was yet in Gilead, and all the people followed him trembling. And he tarried 7 days according to the set time that Samuel had appointed. But Samuel came not to Gilead, and the people were scattered from him. And Saul said, Bring thither the burnt offering to me, and peace offerings. And he offered the burnt offerings. And it came to pass that as soon as he had made an end of offerings, the burnt offerings, behold, Samuel came, and Saul went out to meet him, that he might salute him. And Samuel said, What hast thou done? And Saul said, Because I saw that the people were scattered from me, and that thou camest not within the days appointed, and that the Philistines gathered themselves together at Michmash. Therefore said I, The Philistines will come down now upon me to Gilead, and I have not made supplication unto the Lord. I have forced myself, therefore, and offered a burnt offering. And Samuel said to Saul, Thou hast done foolishly. Thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord thy God, which he commanded thee. For now would the Lord have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever, but now the kingdom shall not continue. Here you can see several things that were wrong with Saul. First, he lost patience in Samuel. And then, after he had done the offerings, he made excuses about it, saying, I forced myself, and it was because of the people. And he also even went to blame Samuel that he wasn't there in the days appointed. But that was a lie.
So as you can see through these different people's lives and these accounts of the Bible, that patience is needed, because if you're not patient, then you might end up making a mistake that could either affect you, other people, or future generations.